Would you please stand? Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Blessed be His kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Receive the prayers of your people who call upon you, and grant that they may know and understand what things they ought to do, and also may have grace and power faithfully to accomplish them. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please do be seated. Well, a very good morning to you all, and welcome to Calvary, whether you are here in person or whether you're joining us online. It's great to be together. A special welcome to you if you're new here. Maybe you're visiting, maybe you're new to Golden. We do have these welcome cards that I hope you see in front of you. If you've not previously completed one of these, I'd encourage you to do so. Hand it in to our host at the end of the service, and we'll be in touch to answer any questions you might have. Just a couple of things to mention in way of announcements. All this week, starting tomorrow, is Kids Camp here in Golden. A number of churches in the community joined together, and there's over 200 kids that are going to be enjoying this week. So please keep them in your prayers. Sunday, July 30th, which is maybe a couple of weekends away, I guess, during Buffalo Bill Days, which is a big celebration here in town, if you were unaware of that, the main stage down in Parfitt Park has been made available once again to the Together Churches of Golden. And so we are planning for a worship service outdoors in the park there. It'll start at 9 o'clock on July 30th. There will be no Great Hall 9:30 service that Sunday. If you'd like to join us in the park, you'd be very welcome. It's a great opportunity. We've also got a wonderful outreach program that's coming up here shortly, the Back to School Shopping Spree, where we help families who otherwise would struggle with all the back to school expenses for their children. So if you'd like to help out with that, you can talk to Bethany after the service. Now, I wonder if anyone has a birthday this coming week. We would love to pray for you. Anyone present got a birthday coming up this week? Okay, I'm aware of a number. So on Monday, it's Rich Treat. Tuesday, Ray Holland. Also on Tuesday, Samuel Cuthbertson turns 4 years old and Liam Leppert, 15. On Wednesday, Glenn Smallman. Thursday, Joel Cuthbertson, Megan Eisenhard, and Jason Weekly. And on Friday, Jan McCullough, Claire Wingrovius, and Daniel Braun turns 17. So let's pray for these brothers and sisters, shall we? Watch over your children, O Lord, as their days increase. Bless and guide them wherever they may be. Strengthen them when they stand. Comfort them when discouraged or sorrowful. Raise them up if they fall. And in their hearts, may your peace, which passes understanding, abide all the days of their lives. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. What about wedding anniversaries? Any couples to recognize this morning? Okay, I'm aware of just two couples. Next Friday, Rocco and Marie Scatella will be celebrating 50 years. And also Willie and Susie Willis, 57 years. So let's pray for these couples. O gracious and ever-living God, you have created us, male and female, in your image. Look mercifully upon this man and this woman who come to you seeking your blessings, and assist us with your grace, that with true fidelity and steadfast love, they may honor and keep the promises and vows they have made, through Jesus Christ our Savior. Amen. This morning, our preacher is Josh Reichen, a Calvary member. He serves on the vestry. I've heard his sermon a little earlier. It's great. You're in for a treat. Josh's two-month-old daughter, June, is due to be baptized at the 9:30 service right after this service. So he's probably going to be making a rapid exit. So you might not get the chance to speak to him after the service. But if you want to talk to me about his sermon, I'm sure he'd be happy to receive a phone call or email. You can reach out to him in that way. Our worship continues. Lord, open our lips, and our mouths shall proclaim your praise. The earth is the Lord's, for he made it. Come, let us adore.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. As the rain and the snow come down from heaven and do not return to it without watering the earth, and making it bud and flourish, so that it yields seeds for the sower and bread for the eater. So is my word that goes out from my mouth. It will not return to me empty, but will accomplish what I desire and achieve the purpose for which I sent it. You will go out in joy and be led forth in peace. The mountains and the hills will burst into song before you, and all the trees of the field will clap their hands. Instead of the thorn bush will grow the juniper, and instead of briars, the myrtle will grow. This will be for the Lord's renown, for an everlasting sign that will endure forever. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please join together in chanting today's psalm.
Thank you.
from Paul's letter to the Romans. Therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, because through Christ Jesus, the law of the Spirit who gives life has set you free from the law of sin and death. For what the law was powerless to do, because it was weakened by the flesh, God did by sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh to be a sin offering. And so he condemned sin in the flesh, in order that the righteous requirement of the law might be fully met in us, who do not live according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. Those who live according to the flesh have their minds set on what the flesh desires, but those who live in accordance with the Spirit have their minds set on what the Spirit desires. The mind governed by the flesh is death, but the mind governed by the Spirit is life and peace. The mind governed by the flesh is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law, nor can it do so. Those who are in the realm of the flesh cannot please God. You, however, are not in the realm of the flesh, but are in the realm of the Spirit. If indeed the Spirit of God lives in you, and if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, they do not belong to Christ. But if Christ is in you, then even though your body is subject to death because of sin, the Spirit gives life because of righteousness. And if the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead is living in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies because of his Spirit who lives in you. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
That same day, Jesus went out of the house and sat by the lake. Such large crowds gathered around him that he got into a boat and sat in it while all the people stood on the shore. Then he told them many things in parables, saying, a farmer went out to sow his seed. As he was scattering the seed, some fell along the path, and the birds came and ate it up. Some fell on rocky places where it did not have much soil. It sprang up quickly because the soil was shallow. But when the sun came up, the plants were scorched, and they withered because they had no root. Other seed fell among thorns, which grew up and choked the plants. Still other seed fell on good soil, where it produced a crop, 100, 60, or 30 times what was sown. Whoever has ears, let them hear. Listen then to what the parable of the sower means. When anyone hears the message about the kingdom and does not understand it, the evil one comes and snatches away what was sown in their heart. This is the seed sown along the path. The seed falling on rocky ground refers to someone who hears the word and at once receives it with joy. But since they have no root, they last only a short time. When trouble or persecution comes because of the word, they quickly fall away. The seed falling among the thorns refers to someone who hears the word, but the worries of this life and the deceitfulness of wealth choke the word, making it unfruitful. But the seed falling on good soil refers to someone who hears the word and understands it. This is the one who produces a crop, yielding 100, 60, or 30 times what was sown. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Brothers and sisters, it's good to be with you this morning. My name is Josh Reichen. As Tim said, I'm a member here at Calvary. And I work at Cross Purpose, which is a partner ministry of ours downtown in Denver. I am preaching this morning for a really special and personal reason. Last night, Taylor Swift played a show at Mile High. I honestly don't know if that's why Tim couldn't be at the Saturday night service, but it is why all five of Anna and my sisters are in town. And because they were here, we thought it'd be a great weekend to baptize Anna June, who was born on May 18th. So when Tim reached out looking for preachers, I politely requested this Sunday to preach. In part, it's because of her baptism. What a fun opportunity to share with you all a few reflections on the faith we share. And it isn't every day you get a built-in object lesson. But also because Romans 8 is my favorite chapter in the Bible. It's a superlative chapter, one of the most straightforward, best chapters in a great letter. And it's especially appropriate for a baptism. Our assigned reading today is through verse 11, but Tim told me he's not preaching through it next week, so I want to address the first half of the chapter through verse 17. I'll let you all listen, but this is partially a sermon for baby June. Today is her baptism, a sign and seal of God's covenant with her. And so I want to give her a sneak preview of the faith we share. What does it actually mean to be a Christian? How do you lead a good life? But I also want to discuss a few practical implications of our faith. We're all believers. What should June expect our lives to look like today and this week as a result? Paul's letter to Romans is particularly helpful. It's an appealing book of the Bible to me. Maybe it is to you too. I keep finding a lot of analytical, rational people at this church across the street from the engineering school. And at least through Romans 8, the book of Romans is a simple, almost linear argument that lays out a logical explanation for the Christian faith. But since we're picking up in the middle of this letter, which wasn't written with verses or chapters, let's give ourselves a little context. Paul is writing to the Romans, the rich urban society whose laws, military, and trading power define life for much of the globe. It's a people living after Jesus, people that will never meet Jesus. So he may as well be writing to us. He's writing about what it means to be a Christian, how it is that the ancient Jewish faith has been dramatically, structurally transformed, and how that faith can and will transform the lives of individuals. The Romans, like us, and unlike Paul, aren't members of the people of Israel. They don't have context for any of this. So Paul has to start really simple to explain the totality of a worldview, a history, and a promise. If you remember, the Jews were God's chosen people. God promised them that they would be abundant and multiply, and that eventually the world would be saved through them. And he makes them a deal. If you listen to me, he says, if you follow my rules, I'll make all this happen. You may also remember that the Jewish people have a pretty hard time listening to God. In our house right now, we read a lot of Curious George. There is almost no more frustrating person in all of literature to me than the man with the yellow hat. The man does not learn from his past experiences. He's always leaving a little monkey alone and expecting a different outcome, but every time George breaks into a circus or out of jail. Israel are like sinful George, or like the worst two-year-old ever. Leave on a hike, they've turned your earrings into a golden calf. Want to take them on a trip out of the desert to live somewhere better? They'll sit on the floor and throw a temper tantrum about how great life used to be. Just disobedience after disobedience. And it seems like they get worse over time, not better. They move from grumbling to disobeying, from a single calf to pervasive idolatry and paganism. They murder, they practice huge sexual sins, their egotistical leaders reject God and get into unwise domestic and international political disputes. They can't even remain one family without schism and heartbreak. Does it sound familiar? And they never listen. It's not that they don't know what to do. While they were down making that calf, Moses was up the hill receiving the Ten Commandments, the laws they were supposed to follow, you know, the laws that say don't murder, don't commit adultery. They know the law and that those laws have punishments. But God is a loving father, and so he puts on his yellow hat and comes down to rescue his chosen people. From the beginning of their relationship, he gives them an out. He says, yes, you know the laws, and the result of your sins is rightly separation from my love. But if you repent, and if you make some animal sacrifices, I'll forgive you. And so for 1,000 years, Israel are stuck on a treadmill of atonement, sinning, repenting, and sacrificing, sinning, repenting, and sacrificing. In response, some of the Jews start to try really hard. They beef up their laws. Even their laws have laws. By the time Jesus shows up, for example, we see that a prohibition against working on the Sabbath has become a prohibition against carrying something on the Sabbath or picking heads of grain as you walk past for a snack. They try to control every little detail of their own behaviors and the behaviors of others. The Romans aren't so different from Israel. They do all the same sins. And of course, that's the point. We all do. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, Paul says in Romans 3:23. And Paul is careful to point out that even if the Romans aren't God's chosen people, they still know right from wrong. Romans 1, he says, "For since the creation of the world, God's invisible qualities, his eternal power and divine nature, have been clearly seen, being understood from what has been made, so the people are without excuse." And to me, and I think to most people, it's pretty obvious that humans are naturally selfish and imperfect. We hurt each other, and we hurt ourselves, and there's nothing we can do to stop. Is that how you feel? Do you feel stuck on a treadmill of self-destructive habits? Are you broken in ways that you can't confess to your church, to your Bible study, let alone to your spouse or your family? Are you unhappy in a way that you think you can't resolve on your own? To me, this is the core of the message of the gospel. Talk to anyone. We all recognize that brokenness surrounds us and is within us. We destroy each other just to get a teeny leg up. We aren't patient with our children, with our spouses, and with those we love. We don't turn the other cheek. We're quick to judge and quick to anger. We suffer, we mourn, we struggle. Jew or Gentile, we're all alike in this way. In Romans 3, Paul says, "There is no one righteous, not even one. There is no one who understands, no one who seeks God. All have turned away. They have become worthless. There is no one who does good, not even one." And the consequences of this are death. We deserve death. Death in an ultimate and final sense at the end of a life unconnected from God, but also that slow death that comes by surrounding yourself in a morass of destructive behaviors. That's the death we all know too well. The anxiety, depression, and sadness that come from repeatedly failing ourselves and being repeatedly failed by others. And so we're all looking for a way out, or at least a way to forget that mutual misery we put each other through. Some of us turn to idolatry. We try to plug money, sex, and substances into the holes in our hearts. We abuse the power dynamics of our relationships to make it feel like we have control. Some of us turn to rule following. We try really hard to avoid any appearance of impropriety. Our laws have laws, so we don't sin. If we all just followed the rules, everything would be fine. This is an unsustainable course. How do I know? The same way you do. We've all been on it. I've been at both ends of that spectrum, and neither have worked out. This is where we found ourselves at the end of chapter 7 last week, when Bethany preached about the selfie that Paul leaves with himself. And for me, at least, it's a little depressing. Even Paul, who should be an example for us, is disgusted by his own sin and can't make himself follow the rules. What a wretched man that I am. Who will rescue me from this body that is subject to death? Well, what's the answer? God provides a way out. He puts his yellow hat back on. Even though we're alike in our sin, there's a solution that applies to all of us, Jew and Gentile. God sends his own son to save us. Jesus' death on the cross is the permanent sacrifice that all of that animal sacrifices couldn't be. And that's what gets Paul so excited. We all have access to this grace. He says in Romans 5, "Therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access by faith into this grace in which we now stand." So that's all it takes to say, I'm a sinner, I accept that death is the right punishment for my sins, and I trust Jesus to pay that price in my place. But now let's talk about freedom, because that's what Paul is talking about in Romans 8. Let's read it in the context of joy. Romans 8 is the thrilling climax of Paul's logical explanation about all these mechanics. He's shown that we're all sinners, that we deserve death, that we Gentiles have no special excuse, that the Jews have no special privilege, and that we can all make the same choice to follow Jesus, who will make good on the deal with God that we never could. And what if we do? Jesus comes. Therefore, there is now no condemnation. Condemnation for who? For you. For me, for June, for all believers in all time. Because of Jesus, God isn't going to condemn us because the price has been paid. Look at verse 1. "Therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus." Let's think about some people from biblical history and what it means for them. Samson was a womanizer. No condemnation. Rahab was a prostitute. No condemnation. Peter was a liar, no condemnation. Noah drank and made terrible decisions, no condemnation. David was a lot of things, no condemnation. And it means the same for you. We are free from the consequences of sin. In an ultimate sense, that means the promise of an eternal relationship with God. We are free from death and damnation. But it also has consequences here on earth. We can be free from trying to live with We can be free to live without the high control anxiety that comes from trying to avoid every sin. We can be free from relying on others who let us down. We can be free from those destructive behaviors that we think help us cope with our brokenness. And there's even better news. You have help along the way. It should be obvious by now from the example of Israel, Paul, from my life, and from your own, that we can't do this on our own. Paul calls this, our broken and sinful humanity, the flesh. The mind governed by the flesh is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law, nor can it do so. Those who are in the realm of the flesh cannot please God. You, however, are not in the realm of the flesh, but in the realm of the Spirit, if indeed the Spirit of God lives in you. And if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, they do not belong to Christ. But if Christ is in you, even though your body is subject to death because of sin, the Spirit gives life because of righteousness. We've got help. And so our lives start to change. Little by little, if you come into a relationship with Jesus, the Holy Spirit starts to change your heart and actions. Ultimately, this leads to eternal life, to a life forever in heaven connected with God. But it also has consequences for our day-to-day life here on earth. Over time, and with God's help, our lives should slowly start to resemble what Paul calls the life of the Spirit. We should find it easier to live into God's will, even if we aren't perfect all the time. and our lives should become more free, more joyful, and more a reflection of Jesus. And so that's the message I will leave June later today, that I will try to always be a prodigal father. I'll love her more than she'll understand till she has a child. I will try to be there, to forgive her, to not to judge her, to be endlessly patient. Every parent does. When she lies, I'll forgive her. When she hurts me, when she hurts herself, when she makes the same mistakes for the fourth time, I'll still love her. If she commits adultery, if she murders, I'll still try to love her. But I have to confess that there are things that will separate her from my love, and most of them aren't her fault. I'm a sinner. It's my own continuing struggle against my sinfulness, my lack of patience, my selfishness. And I can't do anything right to make her, I can't do anything to make her right in the eyes of God, or to do anything to fill that hole that will develop in her heart that we all try to fill with garbage. So that's why we're baptizing her this morning, to point her towards a love that she can't be separated from. So this is what I want to tell her. June, do you see how much I love you? God loves you more. He will always be there in a big yellow hat to rescue you. And do you know how I know? Well, because he rescued me and your mom and Grammy and Granddad and their parents all the way back. There's nothing you can do to separate yourself from his love. All you have to do is trust him. Lying, no condemnation. Disappointing and hurting others, no condemnation. Hurting yourself, no condemnation. Hurting others, no condemnation. Becoming a prostitute, no condemnation. Murder, no condemnation. There's nothing you can do, and you don't need to strive so hard to be perfect. God will accept you as you are. He's the perfect father who won't let you down. All it takes is a relationship with him. Listen to Paul. For those who are led by the Spirit of God are the children of God. The Spirit does not make you slaves so that you live in fear. Again, rather, the Spirit you received brought about your adoption to sonship. And by him, we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we're God's children. Now, if we are children, then we are heirs, heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ, if indeed we share in his sufferings, in order that we may also share in his glory. It's not a choice that I can make for June today. Today is just a sacrament that points her to a future that her family wants for her. It's freely available, and when she's ready, I hope it's a choice she'll make. And until that day, I will keep trying to love her, pushing her in that direction, trying to help her grow into the full stature of Christ. Do you all see how much I love her? God loves you more. Do you see how much I want her to make that choice? God wants the same for you. If you haven't made that choice, it's a choice you can make today. I'm not joking. Find me after the service. You can come interrupt the baptism. It'll be worth it. Most of us in this room have probably already made the choice to be in a relationship with Jesus, but we don't live every day in the freedom of life in Christ. Are you living in the freedom of your faith, or do you feel trapped in the same destructive patterns and behaviors? Sometimes we need to be reminded that we are free from condemnation and reminded of the Spirit's power. Listen to Paul's last little warning in verse 17. He doesn't just say that we get to share in Christ's glory. We also share in his sufferings. That's because we still live in a broken world. The rest of this chapter points to the eternal, permanent healing that will come, but we aren't there yet. That means that in spite of the Spirit's help, we still sin. So let me give you just three little reminders and action items to close. First, don't condemn yourself. This is so hard for me. I lie in bed awake at night and obsess over the ways I've failed myself and failed others. But if God is letting you live free of condemnation, then you should let yourself live in that freedom. Second, check in on yourself. Are you making progress towards life and peace? Or are you remaining stuck in the desires of the flesh? This isn't a graph of linear progress. There will be fits and starts, triumphs and setbacks. But if you are in relationship with Jesus, those things should become easier over time. If you're struggling, ask for help. For me, that starts with prayer. We can pray to Jesus, who's been tempted in every way as we have. We can ask the Holy Spirit to help. And we have each other to rely on. Part of relationship with Jesus is relationship with his people. That's why we come here. That's why we join a Bible study. Sometimes we need love or perspective from someone else. That's part of the baptismal vows we make to support each other in our lives in Christ. And finally, if that is true, then we can't live in condemnation of others. We're a room full of sinners, and yet we keep trying to keep up appearances. But if we take what Paul is saying to be true, then we have enough to worry about with the logs in our own eyes and not the splinters in others. Don't waste your time worrying about trying to control other people's sin. So that's all I have for you today, brothers and sisters. Let's go live in freedom, free from condemnation. Amen?
Amen.
Would you please stand as we affirm our faith using the words of the Nicene Creed? We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made a man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord, saying, Lord, have mercy. For the Holy Church of God, that it may be filled with truth and love and be found without fault at the day of your coming, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For Michael, our presiding bishop, for Kim, our own bishop, and for all the holy people of God, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the mission of the church, that in faithful witness it may preach the gospel to the ends of the earth, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the world, that a spirit of respect and forbearance may grow among nations and peoples, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those in positions of public trust, that they may serve justice and promote the dignity and freedom of every person. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the poor, the persecuted, the sick, and all who suffer, for refugees, prisoners, and all who are in danger, that they may be relieved and protected. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all who have commended themselves to our prayers, for our families, friends, and neighbors, that being freed from anxiety, they may live in joy, peace, and health. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all who have died in the communion of your church, and those whose faith is known to you alone, that with all the saints, they may have rest in that place where there is no pain or grief, but life eternal. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
O Lord, our God, accept the fervent prayers of your people. In the multitude of your mercies, look with compassion upon us and all who turn to you for help.
For you are gracious, O lover of souls, and to you we give glory, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen. We pray to you also for the forgiveness of our sins.
Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things done and left undone. And so uphold us by your Spirit, that we may live and serve you in newness of life, to the honor and glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on us. Forgive us all our sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen us in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep us in eternal life. Amen. Would you please stand? The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Please do share a sign of God's peace with those around you. Peace. 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 Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God. Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, for by water and the Holy Spirit you have made us a new people in Jesus Christ our Lord, to show forth your glory in all the world. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name.
Thank you. We give thanks to you, O God, for the goodness and love which you have made known to us in creation, in the calling of Israel to be your people, in your word spoken through the prophets, and above all in the word made flesh, Jesus your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O Father, we remember his death. We proclaim his resurrection. We await his coming in glory. And we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country where with all your saints we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By him, and with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Which he gave to you, and his blood which he shed for you. Eat and drink in remembrance that he died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
Thank you.
cross. The body of Christ.
Stand. Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, we thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and for assuring us these holy mysteries that we are living members of the body of your Son and heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now, Father, send us out to do the work that you have given us to do, to love and serve you as faithful witnesses of Christ our Lord. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit, be honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. May the Father, from whom every family in earth and heaven receives its name, strengthen you with his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you always.
Amen. Amen.
Let us go forward.